Hello there! Welcome to Skeptic Key Productions. I'm Cryo Grace Kokon. Let's get into the video. Today's video, we're going to be asking the question of what if the Soviet Union never collapsed? Now, just to give a bit of context, we're going to go back to like the mid-1980s in the Soviet Union. Now, the Soviet Union in the 1980s had gone through a few decades of pretty much stagnant economic growth, and had also gone through a series of pretty ineffectual reactionary, pretty much like elderly leadership, yeah. And yeah, so people were kind of beginning to lose faith in the system, yeah. Corruption was rife. As we've discussed in our previous video on what if Russia had become Muslim, so definitely check that out. There had been a high level of alcoholism, which was plaguing the nation. And people were just in general starting to lose faith in the system. And this is, you know, domestically, like, so, you know, there were food shortages, there were, you know, the command economy was basically beginning to disintegrate, and people were starting to feel really down. And, you know, during this time as well, you'd had billions and billions and billions of dollars being wasted on fighting the Americans, like, in the Cold War, with the arms race and fighting all the different proxy wars, around the place. And it didn't help that the Soviet Union didn't really have, like, allies as such. It more had, like, satellite states, which it had to kind of keep in check, yeah, like, against the will of its own people, which meant that they then had to send in lots and lots of troops in order to kind of, you know, keep these people, like, under control. And obviously we saw examples of this in Hungary in 56, and we saw it in Czechoslovakia in 68, and in many other cases like this. And nearly every single one of these satellite states had to be propped up with Soviet money as well. And most notably of all was the case of Afghanistan, in which Soviet funds, Soviet material, and Soviet blood was being spent in order to keep the hills of Afghanistan communist. You know, there had been a revolution in Afghanistan, but this was mainly centered in like the major cities like Kabul. But as is the case today, the vast majority of Afghanistan is very tribal, it's very rural, and the people there don't like foreign ideas kind of being imposed on them. And so the Mujahideen, you know, the soldiers of Allah, they rose up against the communist regime there. And the Soviet troops, you know, were sent in to try and prop up this regime, but they were unable to keep control over much of the territory outside of the major cities and the major highways. And it didn't help also that the Americans, who were trying to get revenge on the Soviets for arming the Vietnamese during the Vietnam War, yeah, they also decided to start arming the Mujahideen, so, and, you know, training them as well. So, yeah, so arming a bunch of Islamic extremists, yeah, that's never going to come back at all. Oh, wait. That's awkward. But anyway, like, this is the 1980s, yeah, and they didn't know any of those things were going to happen yet. Yeah, so to put it lightly, the Soviet Union was in a bad shape. And so it was almost a godsend, yeah, to this atheist country when Mikhail Gorbachev, who's relatively young and he's a great reformer and a modernizer, and he wanted to make like the Soviet Union great again as such. Yeah, he ended up becoming the General Secretary of the Soviet Union. So what he wanted to do was to completely change things up. And he summarized this with two general policies. One was perestroika, which was restructuring of the economy so that it was less centralized, like less top down. So he wanted it to be more along co-ops and like kind of, and yeah, basically more localized kind of organizations. And then on top of that, he also wanted to have glasnost, yeah, which basically means openness. So he wanted people to have the ability to criticize the system with the hope that, like, through this criticism, like, they could make some reforms and, you know, tweak the system in a way that would keep it going and that people would have faith in it still. However, the problem with all this is that glasnost, at the time before perestroika had really kicked in, was pretty much, that's what I think was, like, the death knell of the Soviet Union, because, you know, you can't have people suppressed for, like, almost 70 years and then open the door to criticism. Like, we kind of saw this with the de-Stalinization in the 1950s. You allow people to criticize elements of the system, and all of a sudden you end up having riots and revolutions and stuff, yeah, because people are going, no, we don't like the entire system, and that's the problem, right? However, it's important to note that even today in 2021, there are still some countries which are still communist but don't really look communist anymore. And most notably of all was China. So at the same time, China, Vietnam, and quite a lot of other communist countries, what they basically did was the kind of the equivalent of perestroika without having any glasnost. And the case of Tiananmen Square is a perfect testament to this. So people in the People's Republic of China, they wanted to, actually have a bit of like people power. And in response to that, the communist government there sent in the tanks and massacred the people. When this happened in the Soviet bloc, nothing happened. He didn't send in any tanks. He didn't, like Gorbachev just kind of let the whole thing collapse. And this was probably wise in many ways because it now allowed the Soviet Union to kind of focus in on itself rather than trying to maintain this kind of massive empire and stuff. And yeah, so in a way, it's almost, I don't want to say America first, but it's kind of Soviet Union first. It's interesting enough what Stalin kind of proposed at the beginning of his premiership, which was the idea of socialism in one country. So, you try and focus in on yourself, try and improve things in your own country, and then hopefully other countries follow, rather than this kind of world revolution where you're trying to spread communism all around the world. So in many ways, it would have kind of been a revert back to that. So this is perhaps some of the things that could have been done in order to avoid it. So we're going to kind of dive into a bit more of the alternative history, but before we do that, we're also going to have to give a bit more of the context. So people within the elite classes of the Soviet Union, they benefited a great deal from the corruption that was there. And the last thing that they wanted was for anyone to come in and to try and reform the system, because obviously, if you benefit from the system, why do you want it reformed? And as a result, many of these people kind of conspired with each other, and they came together, and they were behind the August coup. So the August coup, that was when, Soviet tanks rolled through the streets of Moscow. They captured Gorbachev. They captured all the different like things within Moscow and tried to basically take over the entire country again. Much in the same way, actually, that the Bolsheviks first came to power in 1917. That was essentially a coup as well, and they tried to basically do a repeat of that. The problem with all this is that out of the conspirators, there was none who had the same kind of razzle dazzle and like leadership skills of a Lenin or Trotsky, etc. These people were just grey blurs. They were no ones, right? And people were like, who are these people? And so as a result, the whole coup kind of lacked credibility and it kind of quickly collapsed in on itself. The problem with all this, though, from the Soviet Union's perspective, and from Gorbachev's perspective in particular, was that Boris Yeltsin, who was the leader of the Russian Soviet Socialist Republic, he basically took advantage of the situation. So Russia, obviously being the dominant nation within the Soviet Union, he basically stoked up Russian nationalism and used it as an opportunity to dissolve the Soviet Union. Yeah, so as a result, when it came to Boxing Day of 1991, for the last time, the flag was lowered on the Kremlin, and the Soviet Union ceased to be. But this didn't need to necessarily happen, and this is what we're going to go into like now. We're going to go through a list of different things which I think, if they had done differently, the Soviet Union in some form would still exist today. Maybe not in the same way that it had, of course, but yeah, I think it still would exist. And so that's what we'll get into now. So, number one, they would have needed to have done perestroika without the glasnost. So, as we kind of said, they basically would have had to gone down the route of China, where you had market liberalization, all this kind of stuff. We're trying to have cooperatives, but like it still was kind of state run, and it's still, a bit, it's like it's not centralized from Moscow, but it still was kind of quite government run. Yeah, it still wasn't responsive enough to what the market wanted, i.e., what the people there wanted. So people were still having bread queues. Like in 1990 or 1991, I forget the exact year, they opened the first McDonald's, and people all like kind of celebrated and they all queued up for it and stuff. But it was a thing of, it's just, it's too slow. It's just too, like, China was able to do this at a much faster pace, as was Vietnam, and that's because their governments focused on the economic side first. Yeah, they wanted to liberalize their own economy before trying to like get anything else up the road. Because if you allow glasnost, if you allow people to criticize a system where they're queuing for basic things like bread and stuff, it's not going to end well, because people, this is how the February Revolution began in the first place. What was the main thing that Lenin kind of said as an appealing thing? Peace, land, and bread. I know obviously like he said that for the October Revolution, but what was the thing that caused the February Revolution? spread riots in St. Petersburg. So if you don't get the very basic things sorted, people are not going to be happy. It's almost, to quote Bill Clinton once said, it's the economy, stupid. Like, if you can't get the very basic things sorted, then people are not going to be very happy with you. So I think if he had actually done perestroika and in a serious way, and also as well, he didn't have a clear plan of what perestroika would really mean. And he tends to have general feelings of like how things could be better, but he didn't have an exact plan of this is what the end goal ought to be, right? So yeah, so I think if he had been a bit clearer of what he wanted and been like, yeah, we need to do perestroika, and then maybe if we want to do it at a later point when the economy is actually functioning, then we can have some glasnost then. The next thing I'd say is, you know, socialism in one country. So we already saw this obviously with the fall of Berlin Wall and like many of the other places kind of getting their essential independence, and also as well obviously with the Baltic republics getting their independence as well. I think that the Soviet Union, because it was spending so much money trying to prop up all these countries, I think if at an earlier point, as soon as Gorbachev came to power, I think what he ought to have done is, you know, pull Soviet troops out of there. And also as well, of course, pull them out of Afghanistan, because that war dragged on for another like 3 to 4 years, longer than it needed to. Like, Gorbachev came to power and then continued an unwinnable war. And I know we've seen it within our own lifetime, like kind of people like Obama and stuff continuing a completely failed like war in Afghanistan. And it's like, just let it go. Like, it's not going to get any better, but you could be here for 20 years, it's still going to be the same. So yeah, that's you know, so people don't learn a lesson, unfortunately. But yeah, I think if he had pulled back from all these engagements and really focused even more on ending the Cold War at an even faster rate, because yes, he obviously took part in the ending of the Cold War and, you know, had a lot of like peace deals and stuff with America and arms reduction treaties and stuff. However, I feel that he should have done a lot more of this, because then more money could have been then put into like the real economy rather than all this military spending, which wouldn't actually do anything really. So yeah, I think he would have done that. Point number three, I'd say, is cracking down on corruption. This is both at high level and at local level, because, you know, there's a high correlation between the most corrupt countries and the poorest countries. And it's that for a reason, because if you as a businessman can make more money from paying an official than you can actually selling people products and services that they actually want, chances are you're not doing a very good job. Like, your business is not run very efficiently, and you're not actually giving people like things that they're actually wanting. You're just, the only reason why you have any wealth is because you're basically like paying off these corrupt officials who are giving you like the taxpayer money. So big part of it would have been cracking down on the corruption at all levels. I mean, being really, really strict, in the same way that the Chinese and the Vietnamese and other countries did, because yeah, they would have been a lot more serious about it than they actually were in our timeline. So yeah, so I think that's something as well. Because yeah, if they cracked down on the corruption, then people would have had a lot more faith in the system. I think the perfect example in which they could have used a stick to kind of beat corrupt officials would have been the Chernobyl crisis. So, you know, for those who don't know, obviously you had the Chernobyl disaster in 1986. However, the government hid what was actually happening for, I think, something like 18 days. And over that period, people living in that area, they could see what was happening. And they heard what the government was saying, and they knew that the government was lying. And it was like, what the hell? And it's like, it's obviously, throughout the course of the Soviet Union, it's not the first time that the government had done bad things. Obviously, you know, under Stalin in particular, with the purges and the gulags, etc., there had been all these things. But Stalin at least did all those things while also maintaining a reign of terror, so people were too scared to kind of like act out. Whereas Gorbachev did all this, but then also spoke about glasnost. It's like, you can't have openness and then cover something up for 18 days, yeah? So what he could have instead done is said, this was the fault of corrupt officials, this was, you know, incompetent people, etc., which it actually was. Like, there's no need to cover it up. You could have blamed the people that needed to be blamed and just like focus all of the attention on them, all the media attention, and be like, these are the people who are responsible, they need to be held accountable. And if this had been done, then you could have actually got people on your side and given a certain level of credibility and stuff. So rather than trying to deny that there's even a crisis going on, they should have, you know, as the old saying goes, never let a good crisis go to waste. So that's something that they could have done to like actually help kickstart this kind of anti-corruption campaign. And then finally, this is something which a lot of people don't necessarily know. The USSR in 1991 voted to change its name from the USSR to the USSR. Now, that may sound like, what? But yeah, it was, yeah, so it went from the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics to the Union of So it changed from being the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics to being the Union of Soviet Sovereign Republic. That was so hard for me to say, I don't know why. But anyway, yeah, so the Union of Soviet Sovereign Republics. So it's the same acronym, but they changed it from socialist to sovereign. And yeah, so that was a kind of clear indication that they were moving away from kind of socialism, away from communism, and they wanted to be a bit broader of a thing. And actually, there had been referendums across the whole of the Soviet Union. Well, not across the whole of it. There were some countries which, you know, they had already gone down the road of independence. So namely the Baltic countries, you know, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, also Moldova, and Georgia and Armenia. You know, so these countries had kind of opted out because they wanted to become independent. However, all the other Soviet republics, they voted in a referendum where there was high turnout. And as far as I'm aware, there didn't seem to be any evidence of like vote rigging and stuff. But yeah, so you saw very high turnout. And you saw support for like a change from the old system to this new system being supported by about 73% of people. So there was clearly a like demand for there to kind of be this union of Soviet sovereign republics. So yeah, so that's, I think, something that they could have pushed through a lot more. So this was the idea of decentralizing things. Yeah, so giving like the individual republics a lot more autonomy to be able to decide a lot more things. And yeah, so kind of a more federal system, basically, yeah, than was currently the system under the Soviet Union. So yeah, so it would have kind of given power more to the individual republic. So in many ways, this also would have given people a lot more faith in the system, because people from like Central Asia, for instance, or people from like, you know, Belarus or Ukraine, you know, they would have felt a lot less like they were being ruled from Moscow and like, you know, being dominated by the Russians, and they would have felt like they had a bit more of a equal say in the system. But you know what else will give you a much more equal say in the system? If you hit that like button. Well, not really, but like, you can think about it as like voting in a way. Like, you know, in terms of it's a one party state, you either vote for me or you vote against me. But obviously if you vote against me, then might be some consequences, like we know where you live, like etc etc. But anyway, so definitely hit the like button. We've, you know, there's two videos now which we've gone past the 20 likes per video, so you know, really pleased with that. We want that to be done with the rest of our videos as well, so definitely, you know, check out a lot of more of our videos from our various different playlists. Also subscribe if you haven't already, and yeah, share with some of your friends as well. I assume some people have friends. Like, I know I don't. I'm waffling now, so get back into the video by hitting the like button. See, so the main lesson to learn from this is never film late at night when you've had a long day and you're a bit tired because your brain is no worky. Anyway, that's the point. So what have been the result of the Soviet Union not collapsing? Well, we can think about it like this. China today still maintains, you know, the Communist Party at the top, as does Vietnam and many other countries like this. But at the same time, in economic terms, they're incredibly liberal. And, you know, the Soviet Union could have gone down this path as well. So the 1990s are kind of a lost decade for Russia, because the way in which, like, these reforms were done, you know, you hadn't actually dealt with the corruption and stuff. And because the entire system collapsed in on itself, people were like, well, this just became a free-for-all. And anyone who was anyone just, like, kind of started, like, robbing Russia blind, basically. So, you know, this led to high levels of unemployment, high levels of suicide, high levels of alcoholism, high levels of everything, yeah. So, you know, the life expectancy in Russia, like, kind of went down in this time. Everything was just terrible, right? Even Vladimir Putin said that, you know, this time was really, really bad. And, like, it was one of the biggest regrets that the Soviet Union collapsed. And actually, even in many places around the former Soviet Union, people have this nostalgia, not necessarily for Stalin and for communism, etc., etc., but for what the Soviet Union was. You know, this union of sovereign states, essentially, and you know, you kind of continued it with the Commonwealth of Independent States, but it's not exactly the same. Like, certain places are kind of, you know, they're trying to build a Eurasian monetary union and like a customs union and such, but it's they're starting to kind of get back more towards that. Like, certain countries are trying to cooperate a bit more with Russia and etc., but at the same time, it's not exactly what it would have been. And also as well, because the Soviet Union had this massive collapse, it also meant that America, throughout the 1990s and pretty much the 2000s as well, they had this idea of, well, not only of them winning the Cold War, which it would have felt either way, yeah, because, you know, the Berlin Wall came down and etc., etc., and the Soviet Union would have been like kind of pushed back to its own borders as such. So on a strategic level, it would have been a success for them. But I think the fact that the Soviet Union collapsed in on itself and kind of became this big, like, laughingstock, basically, it meant that America, for the first time ever, was a superpower which had no rival. So America, you know, America called the shots in the world, and the world was a unipolar world. And in some ways, that was stable, but at the same time, it meant that America had too much power. And obviously, power tends to corrupt. Absolute power corrupts absolutely. And to have such a powerful country without any kind of like counterbalance was not necessarily good for America, and it led to them being very arrogant and led to them kind of thinking that they could go all around the world and spread freedom and democracy, as they said. And I think that this kind of inevitably led to like what ended up happening with the war on terror, because I think if you'd had a kind of balancing of the Soviet Union, they wouldn't have been like, well, yeah, let's go on this kind of global war on terror. Because like, when you kind of slay all the kind of dragons, the only thing that's left are like lizards, basically. And as bad as kind of like the Taliban and Al-Qaeda and IS were, they were nothing in comparison to the Soviet Union. And the fact that America ended up obviously training many of these Mujahideen who later became these terrorists, it kind of, yeah, they obviously were very effective in the hills of Afghanistan, but like, there's no chance that these people were going to take over the world. So it's, yeah, I think a great deal of hubris kind of came from America not having anyone to kind of keep them in check. And yeah, you need balance within the international world order, really. So if the Soviet Union hadn't collapsed in the way that it did, I think that you would have had obviously a much richer Russia. So like, Russia today is seventh place in the world in terms of the size of the economy. If you hadn't had, like we said, like that lost decade in the 1990s, I think that they probably would have been very like high up there, because, you know, the Soviet Union from 1947 to 1987, as we discussed in our previous video as well, you know, they were the second largest economy, and they were only just about beaten by Japan. And if you hadn't have had this collapse at the same time, they might have at least stayed maybe like top three or four in that ranking. And it's also something to note as well that, you know, the Soviet Union was incredibly dependent on oil, and at the start of the 1980s you had incredibly high oil prices because, you know, of all what was going on like in the Gulf. However, by 1987 oil prices had completely tanked, and so this was another thing which added to it. The saying of like, Rome wasn't built in a day, in the same way you could kind of say like, what was the cause of the fall of the Roman Empire, in the same way, you know, it's not just one thing, it's a multitude of bad things happening all at the same time. And in much in the same way the Soviet Union was like that, it collapsed in itself for multiple different reasons, but I think the main one came down to just simple economics, the fact that they weren't able to give simple like commodities and like just the bare necessities to their own citizens. I think that was the main thing. It's quite hard to have faith in a system where you like it's governed you for over 70 years and yet you're still having to queue for bread. And I think that not being solved, everything else was just an added thing to that. So if they'd liberalized their economy just as China had done, like, I think that they could have made a lot more of these reforms. And you know, Gorbachev is still alive today at the time of filming this video, and there's nothing to say that he couldn't have governed the Soviet Union like throughout all this time. And who knows, like Soviet Union might have been, certainly would have been a more liberal place. Would someone like Putin necessarily have risen to power? Probably. It still could have happened. You might have had a slightly less democratic Russia in this time. However, they would also be more powerful. But also the standard of living for the average Russian today would be higher, as would it be the case for many of the other people in those republics. So there's a reason why a lot of people in the former Soviet Union do lament about it. Because obviously, as much as one can oppose communism, the fact of like these nations being together in a powerful way, in a way that kind of that was mutually beneficial and stuff, I think that that's something to not be ignored. And you know, there's a reason that you had such high turnouts, and there's a reason why you had such high percentage of people that voted to keep like the Soviet Union in intact, or even though obviously you changed the name of it. So yeah, something to just bear in mind is something like, you know, modern history, you know, the world in which I've kind of grown up in, and that most of the people watching this would have grown up in, would be completely different if the Soviet Union collapsed. And whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, you know, let me know in the comments. So, I probably shouldn't be inviting that. Oh, it's going to be like World War III. Anyway, but with that being said, hope you enjoyed this video, and stay tuned for the next video, which is going to be on what if Henry VIII never broke from Rome. So we're going to go back a little bit in history. We're going to kind of cover a lot more kind of British and American history, because I know we've been doing a lot of like European and like kind of, and well, like Russia is part of Europe as well, but like, yeah, but so yeah, we're going to focus a lot more on kind of British and American history. So stay tuned for a lot more of those. We've got, you know, tons and tons of these kind of videos planned, and a lot more on loads of different other topics as well after that. So yeah, I hope you have a great day, and see you next time. Bye.